Here is what was most likely the world's cheapest double cassette boombox back when it was new, sometime in the 1980s. It's a Goldstar TWS-6061, and it is very, very cheap. I rescued this thing from being thrown out, and to be honest, I don't know why. I guess it's just my nostalgia from having something similar to this when I was a kid, although mine was actually a little bit fancier, because mine had high-speed dubbing, while this does not. It says synchro dubbing, but there's no switch for high speed. Also notably lacking is any kind of balance control or tone control or headphone jack or microphone jack. Only jack is the AC power input. And the only controls are volume control, your tape buttons, your function switch for radio, tape, or dubbing, and your selector for AM, FM, or FM stereo, and of course the tuning dial. The speakers have the obligatory fake tweeters. In this case, it's just a decoration. There's no little piezo disc tweeter in there. Or some of these actually put the stereo microphones where it would look like they're tweeters, while this only has a single microphone over here marked C mic. It's a condenser microphone. Probably does not sound good. I'm betting this has DC bias recording. And these are not soft eject, so that's quite the opposite of soft eject. That's harsh eject. So it would not pass the dad test.
Now, who remembers the dad test to find out how good a cassette deck is? Yep, that's right. You press eject, and the slower the door opens, the better the cassette deck is.
The speaker is about 3 inches in diameter. Probably don't sound all that good, but I don't know. I'll have to see what it sounds like when I plug it in and turn it on, if this thing even works. And the graphics are typical for 1980s boomboxes. Very colorful and lots of overselling of the features. There's an FM stereo indicator, and there's your tuning dial, and it even spells out frequency modulation, amplitude modulation, and they give you a log scale of 0 to 10. And then that shows the frequency range of the tuner just to fill up the space on the decal. On the back it says it was made in Korea. I don't know what this little hole here is for. There's nothing in there. Maybe a better model had some kind of input or output jack, and there's the carrying handle. It is UL listed though, and it takes 6 D-cell batteries, and I stored the power cords in the battery compartment, and it has the obligatory paint residue on the cord, as many people play these boombox radios while they were painting. So it was typical for paint to get splattered on these. Close this door back up. Hence the NSFW expression, like a painter's radio. I got the power connected and the antenna extended, so let's prepare to be disappointed here. Okay, that's radio. Scratchy controls, as I expected, considering how much dust is in there. We are on FM stereo, so let's try to tune in a station. And we're getting nothing. Absolutely nothing on FM. Let's wiggle the switch, maybe that's dirty too. I heard something there. So it's trying to work. Yeah, scratchy controls. Ah, there we go. So it just took a little cajoling of that switch to get it in the proper position. Actually doesn't sound as bad as I expected. Now obviously it's lacking bass, but otherwise, it's actually not too terribly bad.
What is that about, do you think?
Every day, don't try to hide.
Here's an appropriate 80s song to be playing on this.
Just very unrealistic. So
gets surprisingly loud. All right, let's try AM.
Concluded, when he's not in town, that helps us do.
Reception and sound quality are not the best on AM, but it's okay. It's pretty much what I expected. And I have no idea what language that is. Let's try some Johnny Hates Jazz and we'll see if Goldstar hates Johnny. You gotta put him in upside down. Yeah, that doesn't sound good. Didn't eat the tape though. It's moving. Maybe the belt is worn out. It's trying. It's getting better. Slowly. Alright, let me wait a while, see if it gets up to normal speed. Still not quite making it, except if I put a little pressure on the pause button to relieve some of the pressure on the pinch roller. That helps speed it up. Again, that doesn't sound actually that bad. Let's try the other one. Nothing. You can hear the motor running, but let's see. Yeah, the things do move, but it just doesn't have enough tension in the belt to actually move the cassette. So clearly the belts are worn out. So it actually sounds a little better than I expected. And to be honest, if I was like 8 or 9 years old back in 1980 whatever when this was new, I probably would have been happy with this. To have my own double cassette boombox. Copying friends' tapes, making my own mixtapes. I'm pretty sure the recording is DC biased, so it probably sounds terrible, but hey. My first boombox, like I mentioned, was similar to this, except it had the high-speed dubbing, and it was DC biased, and it made terrible-sounding recordings, but as a kid, it was fun to just make recordings at all. That was the whole excitement of it. Not the fact that it sounded good, just the fact that I could record anything I wanted from tapes or from the radio. It was a lot of fun to have back in the day. I think the tape actually sounded better than the radio. It had a little bit better of a bass response, if you can even call it bass. I got a cassette single, and I put it in this side, and it's almost playing at the correct speed without me needing to press my finger on the pause button. So So Sting is sounding a little sluggish, but otherwise not too bad. It's surprisingly loud.
But this is we'll see how it's we'll see how that bass sound is sounding now. This is a kick drum twist.
At this point, I'm spending way too much time on something that's not really worth it, but in for a penny, in for a pound. I really just wanted to be able to clean the volume control because, as you can see, it's at a right angle, so if I tried to spray in through the top, it wouldn't even get to it. And on this board, you can also see the pinout for where a headphone jack would have gone if this was equipped to fit. And there's also a pinout for a DIN jack, I guess for a European version. And there's the single motor that runs both of the tape decks. The belts are all intact, they're just kind of loose. So that's why it's not really running at the correct speed. And there's all the tuner circuitry. And the build quality is pretty much what I expected, with capacitors just sort of stuck in at any angle and not really caring about how neatly it was assembled. And over here on the power supply board, hiding under all these cables, is a Sanyo LA4550 amplifier. It's 2.1 watts at 10% distortion, so somewhere around 1 to 1.5 watts. At a more reasonable level of distortion, and that's when it's running at 9 volts, which this circuitry is. And this video is not sponsored by Deoxit. It's kind of funny, I just got a message from the company that makes Deoxit offering to send me free Deoxit to use in my videos. I wrote back and I said, I'm not going to tell my viewers to use Deoxit because I use the cheap stuff, and for my purposes it works just as good. And they wrote back and said, oh, no, we're not trying to promote Deoxit. We just want to have it in your videos, basically just product placement. So even if I didn't mention it, people would see me using Deoxit and they would want to buy it. But in this case, this is what I have and it works just as good. Maybe there's some specialized applications where Deoxit actually works better, but for just cleaning a scratchy volume control, the cheap stuff works perfectly fine. You just spray it in, move it back and forth. And this thing too, the record playback switch. A little bit harder to get to, but that should clean it up. So if you're using a tape recorder and you go to play a tape or record a tape and all you get is noise or a loud squealing, it's probably because this record playback switch inside the machine is dirty, so you just need to clean the contacts. That usually fixes the problem. Now that I have it all back together, I tried making a recording. The belts don't have enough tension to run a full-size tape, but it's fine for a short tape like this Radio Shack computer cassette. 10 minutes total length, so it's 5 minutes per side. And I tried recording using the built-in microphone and it picked up absolutely nothing. Maybe just a faintest whisper of my voice, but you couldn't even hear it. But I tried recording from the radio and that worked fine.
Don't trouble for that.
Quality is about what I expected for stereo DC bias.
Dickerson and Hood, Mike Golick Jr. and Doug Kazarian filling in. I almost got through.
It's actually not too sibilant when you're recording from the radio, because FM radio, the high end, has a similar emphasis curve to cassette tapes, so that's why you don't really get that sibilant splatter when you're recording.
3, Drew Miller, they're going crazy in Arizona. Gonzaga beats South Carolina, 77-73. Gonzaga popping the champagne. They're going to the finals Monday night.
I happen to catch a radio station playing this same song that's on this single, and I'm recording it. So what I'll do is I'll play a clip from this recording made from the radio on this cheap boombox recorder on my good Nakamichi cassette deck, and then I'll play a clip from the actual cassette single so you can compare the quality. So that's the Goldstar TWS-6061 double cassette boombox from the 1980s.
Oh, but they're turning your way, he's down.